Good evening, everybody. Welcome to Shakespeare and Company. New York City, 1942. Una, socialite daughter of playwright Eugene O'Neill, meets Jerome, son of Sol and Miriam Salinger, a young writer with a handful of short stories under his belt. They're drawn to each other, they date, and that's more or less as much as we know about one of the most enticing celebrity pairings of the mid-20th century. Frustrating, right? Well, it would be, except thankfully, Frédéric Beigbeder is here to fill in the blanks. Combining in-depth research, a finely tuned novelist's instinct, a fanboy's obsessiveness, a romantic's heart, and now, in this new English edition, more than 100 sumptuous illustrations by Raphael Alterio, Manhattan's Babe is a tale elegantly told, at times comical, at others devastating, about how lives converge, diverge, and sometimes converge again, and how first love, whether it endures or not, has a lasting impact on our lives. Fact, fiction, or faction. We're with Frederick when he writes at the beginning, "I would like to solemnly declare that if this story happened not to be true, I would be extremely disappointed." Frédéric Beigbeder is a literary critic, filmmaker, and television and radio host. He's the creator of the Prix Flore and chairs its jury, and he's also editorial director of Louis magazine. Somehow, he also finds time to write novels, and pretty damn good ones at that. Of which Una et Salinger, the French title for Manhattan's Babe, is the 9th or 10th, maybe. We're losing count.
Oh, my publisher is here. I don't know.
Among his various honours, he won the Independent Foreign Fiction Prize for Windows on the World in 2005, and in 2009 he received the Prix Renaudot for Un Roman Français. Please welcome Frédéric Beigbeder to Shakespeare and Company.
Danke schön.
We need to switch languages.
I see a few friends outside that maybe want to come in, but I don't know what to do. Do I have the power to let people in? Or
yeah, we'll go around and get them.
No? Ah, okay. Thank you so much. Thank you, Sylvia.
Well, I said welcome to Shakespeare and Company. I should say welcome back. You were here a couple of years ago. Mm-hmm. And I believe you also used to visit when you were a little boy.
Oh yeah, I was a cashier here. Yeah. I did sometimes, and I was very bad at counting, mm-hmm. so I gave too much money back.
Uh-huh. But at the age of like 7 or 8 or yeah. something like that, right?
So the clients loved me, mm-hmm. of course. I was very not good at mathematics. Mm-hmm. So I'm very happy when you say welcome to Shakespeare. As I arrive, uh-huh. you know, that's very nice. What can I say? It's important to say that I'm not the only author of this book. This is Adam Biles, my translator, the translator of Manhattan's Babe. So, yeah. It's very important because I think a translator, when he's good, can improve the original version, which you
That's
did.
That's what I tried to do.
Exactly, yeah. So I want to say, and I'm not saying this only for sales, but this one is better than the previous one, much better. And especially for stupid reason is that it's happening in New York and all the characters are Americans, except Charlie Chaplin, of course, who is English. But in the French version, all these people were speaking French, which is absurd. So now they are speaking like if you look at a movie in the original version. And when I read it in English, thanks to you, I was very happy of my work.
Well, I tried to do it justice anyway. Let's talk a little bit about the origins of the book, which you say near the start, at the beginning of the 2010s, you were suffering from what do you call a gerontophobia, a fear of elderly people.
Yeah, which is one of our big differences, because in your last book you talk only about old people. I am less mature than you are.
I'm old before my time.
And it's a disease, and I'm not cured yet. I'm working on it, but still I'm fascinated by youth, mm-hmm. and I don't want to grow old, and I think it's Salinger's fault. Mm-hmm. So
explain yourself.
Yeah, he wrote this book called The Catcher in the Rye and many novels, many short stories about young people. And since then, since he published that, just after the war, mankind is afraid of getting old. It's his fault. He's one of the people who gave us this impression that old people were not sexy. Mm-hmm. And that the only important period in the life is between 15 and 25, something like that. Maybe 25 is too old mm-hmm. for Salinger. So, I try to explain why he's like that mm-hmm. in this book. It's the story of a guy who is disappointed mm-hmm. by adult because he's seen what adults can do.
Yeah. And you're saying it's Salinger's fault. You're blaming Salinger, and yet you're a massive Salinger fan, and I think it was 2007, 2008, you went to the United States in search of mm-hmm. Salinger to try and track him down, to try and meet him.
Yeah, because I had a dream, a nightmare, that he was dying, and I wanted to see him before that. Mm-hmm. And I did not succeed because I was too shy and too a coward. And so I did not disturb the old man in his house.
Too polite.
Too polite. Well. Yeah. It's my mother's fault. you must get used to this. It's always someone else's fault when I have a problem. And because of my mother, I did not disturb this old man. But I wrote this book, so in a way it's worse, because I'm telling about his private life, about his sex life, about all those things that he didn't want anybody to know anything about during all his life. And maybe that's why it's a French guy who wrote this book. I don't think this book was possible in the States for many different reasons.
And you say you're writing about his, you know, his sex life and all this kind of stuff, but it's one of the few books actually about Salinger which is kind about Salinger as well. I mean, often people write these memoirs in which he comes off terribly badly. And it's rather, in Manhattan's Babe, it's quite an affectionate portrait of Salinger.
Because it was before success. He was only a young man trying to become a writer. So he was writing short stories that were not published, and then they got published in few magazines. But it was before he published his first novel and became famous. And I think it's a book also about how to become a writer. Why do we write, and how do we become, and why? What are we looking for in writing? I think his love story, this total failure with Oona, is one of the reasons.
Mm-hmm. You're giving away the ending there. Maybe everyone didn't know that. But so there's this weird moment of serendipity. So you're in the United States, you're in Salinger's favorite diner, and then you see a photo on the wall. And the photo you see is of a young woman, of Oona, in fact. And it's fascinating that you should be in this diner that is known as Salinger's favorite, and there on the wall they have the photo of his first love.
And I see this beautiful girl, so maybe that's also a good reason to write a book mm-hmm. when you have found a muse. Mm-hmm. And she had everything. She was rich, famous, beautiful, clever. And also, when you dig and you start to make some research about her, the worst childhood ever. Her two brothers committed suicide, and her father ignored her from the age of 8 years old. So she saw her father only in the newspapers. Eugene O'Neill, the famous playwright. And so it was very sad and very sexy at the same time.
And so there's this moment where, at the beginning of the book, we meet young Jerry and we meet young Oona. And again, I said sort of it's one of the books that treats Salinger kindly. It's also one of the few things I've read, possibly the only thing I've read, that talks about Salinger as a young man. So again, there's plenty of memoirs of people who met Salinger when he was the famous writer, when he was the recluse or the hermit or whatever you want to call him. But there's very little has been written about Salinger as a young man. So can you just talk a little bit about your process of getting to know young Jerry Salinger?
Well, you know, I love to work, but I'm also very lazy. Mm-hmm. So I thought this period is so, we don't know anything. It's so mysterious that there is a plenty of room for imagination. What we have is all the témoignage,
the witnesses
of the war, of the GIs who came to France because Salinger was in Normandy and then in Paris and then he went to Germany. So he did this, what I call the l'année la plus longue, the longest year. And so we know a lot about what he went through. But we don't know anything about him personally.
So how did you get in the head of young Jerry? Did you take inspiration from the characters in his fiction? Maybe Holden Caulfield, maybe that story, The Heart of a Broken Story, that mm-hmm. Justin Horgenschlag. Did you try and find
sure.
Jerry Salinger in those voices?
Of course, and especially since there is very few stories that are published, but a lot that we can find now on the internet. So there are 22 unpublished short stories that are now very easy to read, and also the letters. I was lucky to see the letters that he wrote to Oona O'Neill, but I don't know how I got them. I don't want to say, but it's so. It's a beautiful one-way love story, very sad and very romantic. When I discovered this story, I thought it was very surprising that no one ever wrote before mm-hmm. about that. There is everybody. Her best friend was Truman Capote mm-hmm. for all her life. Salinger met Hemingway in Paris at the Ritz in 1944, and they were writing to each other during all the war. Orson Welles tried to seduce Oona before Charlie Chaplin, and when she married Chaplin, she met the whole world, mm-hmm. Gandhi, Churchill, everybody. Mm-hmm. So it's quite, c'est rare,
it's rare.
It's mm-hmm. rare to find a story like that.
Mm-hmm. And this is it as well, so at the beginning of the story we have the sort of the purity of their meeting. And I think we're going to hear a little bit from the book in a moment from the wonderful Lola Peplow, who's going to be reading for us tonight. So this is, let's set up their meeting. So this is 1942. This is in
1940. Yeah, yeah.
This is the Stork Club.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about the Stork.
1940 is a very funny year because France is occupied, but in New York they still party every night. And so it's difficult to imagine.
Not because France is occupied. We've got to
maybe
be clear about
that. No. So there was this place called the Stork Club that Fitzgerald wrote many times about. It's a very small bar where all the intellectuals, the writers, the movie stars were going. That's where she was going every night. Oona O'Neill with her best friends Gloria Vanderbilt and Carol Marcus. They were nicknamed the It Girls. They were the first It Girls, I think, in contemporary history. So they were not paying the drinks. The owner of the place invited them because she was famous as the daughter, like Paris Hilton, for example, or Ivanka Trump. You see, she was a kind of girl like that. Like she had her pictures in the Socialite pages of the Post. So she went there,
and yet Jerry wasn't from that kind of background at all.
No,
that needs to be
too. No, his parents were not very rich, but still they lived on Park Avenue, so mm-hmm. it was okay. but he went there, and we know that they met there, and also Capote and Orson Welles, and all
so
these people went there.
This is a dark club in the 1940s. There's a moment you say everyone in the 1940s, everyone smoked everywhere.
Yeah.
So it's a smoke-filled bar. There's a swing band
exactly
always on stage.
You can see kind of attempt to reconstitute this place in Café Society by Woody Allen. I'm not sure it was he tried to do the Stork Club exactly, maybe the 21, but it's mm-hmm. similar.
Yeah.
So if you've seen Café Society, it's mm-hmm. the kind of atmosphere. So
keep
describe.
keep that atmosphere in your head while we welcome Lola Peplow to the lectern to hear our first extract from Manhattan's Babe.
I raise my glass to Francis Scotch Fitzgerald, said Truman. Do you write, Jerry? Carol said. You've got a writer's mug. I can spot a writer in a crowd of thousands. They're filthy egoists, frightfully intelligent, and to be avoided like the plague. Do you think he looks intellectual? Gloria asked. He doesn't say much, does he? Jerry was wishing that he'd never heard that name. Oona. It rang like a groan of pleasure. Ooh, followed by a scream of release. Ah. And between the two vowels, the consonant that evoked the moon. This name was as hypnotic as its owner. Jerry told himself that men would always be able to fall flat on their faces if there were women like her around to pick them back up again. I've never seen your father's plays, he said, but I know he's one of our greatest playwrights. Not the greatest, Truman said, the only. He was the first one to write about the poor. I don't know if it was such a good idea, all those depressing sailors, big-hearted prostitutes, suicidal dropouts. What a downer. Since his Nobel, he's become a national treasure, Jerry corrected him. He had no idea, but wanted to make the girl happy by standing up for her father. He also couldn't stand gratuitous socialite aggression. He found it more inspiring to be funny without insulting people, which meant he wasn't funny often. More than anything, he's a bad father, Oona concluded, exhaling her cigarette smoke toward the ceiling as if she were lying on an analyst's couch. The Irish are all drunkards, Truman said. Find me an Irishman who doesn't drink. Writers are allowed to drink, Carol said, but for fathers it's not advised. I'd love to know his work, Jerry went on. You see, my problem, Miss O'Neill, is that theatres make me uneasy. I always want to cough when you absolutely mustn't, and I always feel like I'm on the creakiest seat in the whole room. I don't know why I'm never able to forget that I'm sitting in front of human beings who are paid to recite dialogue, and the actors pass on their stage fright to me. I'm dead scared that they'll forget their lines. There's also the spit, Truman said. At the theater, it's best to avoid the front few rows, or at least to come with a good umbrella. Forgive me, Jerry said. I bet you're fed up with people speaking to you about your father. It's not an easy name to have, Oona said. I consider myself more of an orphan than anyone's daughter. It's strange, being the orphan of somebody who's both alive and famous. Everyone speaks to me about him as if we're close, whereas I've only seen him 3 times in the past 10 years. Oona shut up, annoyed at having confided something so intimate to a stranger. Sensing her friend's embarrassment, Gloria came to our assistance, singing, "Heedy, heedy, heedy, ho!" The orchestra was playing Minnie the Moocher a little too loudly. The vibrations of the double bass were making the mahogany-covered walls tremble. The song tells the story of a prostitute, looked after by a coquette. Would have been the subject of one of Una's father's plays. It's always amusing to see the middle classes singing violent lyrics in unison. At dinners with respectable families in the presence of small children, I can't help smiling when everyone hums Walk on the Wild Side and mimics Lou Reed's do-de-do-de-do-de-do-de-do-do, unaware he's telling the story of a transvestite prostitute. Listen, Gloria Vanderbilt said, so much the better that I inherited the family fortune. But I'd happily do away with all the rest, the photos, the gossip, the gigolos, the crooks. What a mess. Truman, be a darling and order another round of vodka martinis. Gloria's family built half of New York but demolished her childhood. While signaling to the maitre d', Truman changed the subject. Whenever something painful came close, Truman ran the other way. It was a question of survival. That's what made him the most seductive teenager in New York. All these fatherless girls, he said to Jerry, somebody needs to look after them. They escape from Park Avenue to study drama. All Upper East Side girls do theater because they all want to be loved, and the people who are supposed to love them have gone to the Hamptons for the weekend. My father's in Paris, and my mother's in Los Angeles, Oona said. Look at Orson over there, Carol said. My God, he's sinister. Has he never acted in an O'Neill? He really should. I could easily see him beating his depressed wife with an empty bottle. I think he's almost handsome, Gloria said. I loved it when his radio show made everyone believe the Martians were attacking Broadway.
Thank you so much, Lola. And so this is the Stork Club. Jerry and Una meet. They have this. There's this wonderful scene in the novel where by the seaside they spend.
At Point Pleasant, New Jersey.
They spend a romantic evening together, and then that's when their lives begin to diverge.
Yeah, I wished I could stay at the Stork during all the novel. That was my goal, you know. But unfortunately, that's not what happened. Mm-hmm. So I tried to stay as long as I could inside this club with all those beautiful people drinking vodka martinis.
That makes me think of something. I think you said in an interview that you thought it would be like a Fitzgerald novel.
Sure.
When you started, and that's what we find in the Stork, but then
thank you very much for comparing me to my idol. But what happened is that he was drafted, went to train for the D-Day, mm-hmm. and so he didn't see Una again for a very long time. Mm-hmm. He went to Great Britain, mm-hmm. to a training camp for the débarquement, the invasion. Mm-hmm. C'est marrant. We in French we say débarquement, but in English it's invasion.
Yeah, or the landings.
And then, so he was in there. That inspired him this beautiful short story, "For Is Me," with love and squalor. Mm-hmm. But she went to Beverly Hills. Mm. She wanted to become an actress, so she went to try to make some tests with a few directors.
That's probably the most extreme divergence in two lives that you can imagine. And there's a moment you put the words into her mouth where she says, "I'm not going to let Adolf Hitler ruin my youth." and we've got to remember she was very young. She was only 17 at this point. Mm. And so there's this strange atmosphere of New York during, as you said, sort of France is invaded, Europe is at war, and yet New York, sort of the party continues.
Party still goes on until Pearl Harbor, mm-hmm. So the end of 41, mm-hmm. which makes 2 years. Mm-hmm. So it's good long party for 2 years. And it was interesting for me to play with this contrast, mm-hmm. the contrast between the lightness of Los Angeles, the summer, the Charlie Chaplin's villa in Beverly Hills, and all those beautiful people having cocktails, and at the same time, what was happening in Europe.
Mm-hmm. And there are some moments in the book where it's very stark, the contrast. I think there's a moment where you list what happened a certain summer, mm-hmm. between Beverly Hills and Europe, and we really feel it in the gut as readers.
It's it's interesting, but it's not very special to to this era. We could do the same today. Mm-hmm. We could perfectly have a funny scene where you have people at Shakespeare and Company talking about literature, and at the same time people are dying under the bombs in a few places on Earth. It's always like that, and just for a novelist, it's a way to speak about frivolous characters, but also feel a little deep sometime, mm-hmm. you know, and feel serious. And I'm always working on this and try to become a serious writer.
Mm-hmm. And so Una heads west, and she wants to become an actress. And as you said, she meets Orson Welles. And this was one moment when I was reading and translating the book that I remember thinking, okay, this is maybe. Frederick is going a bit far, and then we realize it's an anecdote which Chaplin, I think, recounts in his autobiography.
Yeah, and also Orson Welles told this many times in his life in books and interviews. Yeah, he sometimes when you start to write about a real story, you make some research and you find things that are so crazy that I had to put footnotes in the book just to make the reader believe me, because it's difficult to believe that Orson Welles in fact told Una she was going to marry Charlie Chaplin.
He read her palm, in fact, at the end of a lunch, and she didn't believe him.
Yeah. And but when I told this to the daughter of Una and Charlie Chaplin, Annie, she said everybody was sleeping with Charlie Chaplin at this time. So it was not an amazing prophecy, you know.
And everyone thought they would
marry him. You're going to fuck with. It's like today if you talk about George Clooney or, you know, I don't know, somebody like that.
But Una does get to meet Chaplin, and
In fact, he really fell in love at first sight. Mm-hmm. And so this, again, we know exactly where and when it happened, mm-hmm. but we absolutely have no clue about what they said mm-hmm. to each other. So I tried to imagine, and now I will look very ridiculous.
Having only ever seen him in black and white, Una was surprised by Chaplin's blue eyes. He was thin, attentive, short like her father, 5'5" with that famous face sans moustache, gray hair, and a strange way of moving, as if he was dancing. He was wearing a 3-piece dark gray suit and a blue tie, which brought out his eyes. He was 54 years old. He looked like the tramp, but elevated to the bourgeoisie. Were there any other actors who became millionaires while playing vagrants? I don't think it would be possible today. Like all professional comics, Chaplin was very serious, almost sinister, but he tried to break the ice. Have you been in Los Angeles for long? A few weeks. A friend of mine just got married, and my mother lives here. Mina told me you trod the boards a little in New York. Oh, nothing much, just a little role in a musical. I played the ingenue in Pal Joey last summer at the Maplewood. It's a good play. Why do you want to be an actress? Una thought about this and blushed, because she knew it was an important question. Charlie sensed her discomfort. They were as shy as each other. And yet Charlie was a ladies' man. In truth, he spent much of his life with real pains in the ass who were only after his money and used him to break into movies. It was possible that Una's shyness was catching. Every time she met someone new, there was silence. She got used to this phenomenon a long time ago and supposed it was her fault. In company, she was the expert at creating an awkward vibe. You don't have to answer, Chaplin said. Perhaps my question was indiscreet. Oh no, it's not the question that's the problem, it's the answer. I want to be an actress because I'm not interesting, because I don't know who I am. Because I feel vague, hollow, empty. Because if I'm asked to be myself, I don't know what that means. Because I always want someone else to whisper to me what I have to say. I also want to be an actress so I can be applauded and loved by everyone. But that's a side issue, really. There you go. Did I answer your question well, Mr. Tramp? The young woman had turned scarlet, but her damp and piercing eyes were issuing a challenge. As Una's and Charlie's eyes met, they welled up simultaneously. It would be unfit to talk of a coup de foudre, a flood would be more appropriate. If I were Boris Vian, I would write here what he said when Colin met Chloe in Froth on the Daydream. An abundant silence spread around them, and most of the rest of the world faded away to nothing. Fortunately, Mina Wallace came into the room at that moment, otherwise the double drowning would have become really awkward. Sorry I'm late, Mina said, though I confess I took my time on purpose so you could get to know each other. What are you drinking? A gin and tonic, please, Charlie said. The same, thank you, said Una. As an alcoholic's daughter, I can say that I have no problem holding my gin. Una, Charlie said, can I ask you one more indiscreet question, after which I promise to leave you alone? Yes. How old are you? 17. My goodness, Charlie said. I'm 3 times your age. Normally I could be the father of my actresses, but this is the first time I could be their grandfather. I don't see what the problem is. I'm much more mature than you are. It's true. You don't walk around with holes in your shoes, a cane, baggy trousers, and a bowler hat. Neither do you, outside of office hours.
Mm-hmm. this was a very sadistic moment mm-hmm. to make Lola say everything about why actresses are actresses. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I apologize, it's very cruel. I didn't do it on purpose, a little.
There's a... there is something, because I think at the beginning when you have Jerry meet Una, as a reader, we are rooting for them to be together. We want Jerry and Una to be a couple. But then when we have this scene where we see Una meet Charlie, suddenly we're a little more confused. Suddenly we're pulled in different directions. And of course we know that Una and Charlie stayed together for the rest of Charlie's life. Now, we have that scene, so we're in Los Angeles, where, the war is going on, but it seems very distant. We have this enormous contrast. Let's talk about Jerry in Europe. And this was, for me, one of the moments that really I felt my guts were being pulled out, like reading this book, the sort of the what Jerry had to go through, which was not necessarily more extreme than any normal soldier would have to go through. But it seemed... There's a section where you say, which you entitle, What French People Aren't Told About the Normandy Landings in High School, or something like that. And it seemed to be a part of your intention to bring home quite how horrible and how traumatic this experience was for Jerry.
Well, I did not study the war very carefully before writing this book. So I learned many, many things, and it was very interesting for me, and I thought maybe my readers are as stupid as I am, and maybe I should describe in details what it was. But the thing is, what you are saying that Jerry was not very different from the others. Well, he was not very lucky, because I talked, for example, to James Salter, who was in the Korean War, and he met Irvin Shaw, who was also a soldier in World War II, and Irvin Shaw said he saw nothing compared to Salinger. Salinger is the writer, the American writer of the 20th century, who've seen more, who've seen the most of horrors, because he was a GI, he was in the infantry, so he was in the front line and saw 75% of his regiment die. And then he went to Paris, and that was fun because everybody was making love. But then after that he went to another battle, a horrible battle in Hürtgen Forest in Germany. So he was really... There are many writers who wrote about the World War II in America, but it's the interesting thing is that Salinger is the one who saw the most terrible things and never wrote about it. And this is very... That also adds to the mystery of his work. I think all his work is about World War II, mm-hmm. but never talks really about it, mm-hmm. except the suicide of Seymour Glass in Banana Fish.
Of course, yeah. And that's fascinating, in fact, that sort of... it's almost... That sort of the more you see, the less you want to write about
that's
it.
That's very, very strange. And Hemingway wrote about the war a mm. great deal, but he didn't. He wasn't in the infantry. Mm. He was a journalist, so he was protected in a way.
Sure.
I'm not saying he's not a hero, but it's not the same.
When you started researching it, when you started to find out what Jerry had been through during the war, did you feel your idea of Salinger changing, and did you feel that you started to maybe understand the steps that his life would take after that?
Exactly, yeah, totally. It's very well. I knew that when you read The Catcher in the Rye, of course, it's the mind of a post-traumatic stress disorder veteran inside the body of a teenager. This explains why he has this rage and this why he's so angry. But also, if you think about it, all the books are about the same family, the Glass family, and this family is destroyed by the war, destroyed by the suicide of one of the brothers, and everybody becomes crazy because of the war. So what Salinger tried to tell us is that America was going to become a crazy country because of so many people had died and seen horror.
And if I remember rightly, in one of the short stories that you're talking about, the uncollected short stories, we discover that Holden goes missing in action as well, I think, in the Second World War.
Exactly, yeah. There are some other short stories that are not published where the character appears. Mm-hmm. It's too bad that the family and the estate refuses to publish all the work of Salinger. It's really, I think... We have to do something about it. I'm always trying to explain that. But when you know, Kafka, for example, asked his best friend to destroy Der Prozess and the castle also. And Max Brod, his best friend, refused to destroy it and published it after Kafka was dead. And if Max Brod did not disobey his friend, we would never be able to read that. Mm. And I think now it's time for the family, for Salinger's wife and his son, and also his agent. I'm looking at the camera. think about that. It's not a question of respecting the will of a great father or husband. It's about the history of American literature of the 20th century, and it's bigger than you, me, and all of us.
And if we're talking about the history of 20th century American literature, so Salinger arrives in Paris, and as you've already mentioned, meets Ernest Hemingway. Now, this is sort of such a tantalizing meeting. I mean, just the idea at the Ritz Hotel. We know that it happened.
August 26, 1944, exactly.
And again, we know, beyond the fact that it happened, we know very little.
We know nothing. Mm-hmm. It lasted 2 hours. Mm-hmm. Salinger was 25. He was published in Esquire, and Hemingway was published in Esquire too. And when you publish a short story in Esquire, you had your picture. The reason why Hemingway accepted to meet this young guy is maybe because he was published in the same magazine. And he said, Salinger knew that Hemingway was going to the Ritz. I don't know how he knew that. Mm-hmm. Maybe because in the army, news go very fast. And he took a jeep and went to the Ritz just to see if Hemingway was there. And so all the biographies of both attest that this is true, but we don't know what they talked about. And that, again, for a writer, for a novelist, it's an incredible luxury to be able to imagine and try to know what.
And we're going to bring Lola up in a moment again to hear what what you imagined. But I'm just intrigued by. I mean, but where do you start with that? It's a luxury. I mean, to imagine. But was there a moment where you thought, okay, I think they're going to. I think they would have talked about this.
Well, I imagine if what I would do if I met such an important writer, much older than me and much more famous. Hemingway was then one of the most famous writers on earth. If I was, and in fact, it did happen a few times in my life that I met somebody I really admire. And I think you talk about your work, you talk about his work, you talk about how to write. It's obvious that what the best way to connect is to make compliments.
And that sense of sort of the meeting of minds and sort of the sort of treating each other as peers as well, which I think was to an extent.
Yeah, and also in Hemingway, many times people told me he was not very nice. When he drank, he became aggressive. That's what Bud Schoelberg told me, for example, when I met him in Deauville. He wanted to box Bud Schoelberg when they met. But Salinger wrote a letter which is in the book, quoted in the book. Salinger wrote that Hemingway was much nicer than what he thought. Mm-hmm. So I could not imagine them boxing each other in the Ritz, which have been great. Mm-hmm. Could have been great. So
quite short, though, I imagine. Well, let's hear what you did imagine for the third and final time. Over to Lola.
Want wine?
Oh, okay.
It's important, yes.
Salinger has heard that America's most famous war correspondent is holed up at the Ritz. As a budding writer, there's nothing he wants more than to meet his master. As cell phones don't exist, he decides just to chance it. He borrows a jeep, charges to the Ritz on the Place Vendôme, and at the front desk asks for Monsieur Ernest Hemingway. The inundated receptionist replies that Mr. Hemingway is in the bar. The moustached one is swaggering about, Bordeaux in hand, surrounded by a court of soldiers. He's claiming to have liberated the palace. To his great surprise, when Jerry introduces himself with, "My name is Salinger, Jerome Salinger," Hemingway greets him like an old colleague and invites him to sit at his table in the bar that will one day bear his name. Dressed in shirt sleeves and dirty army slacks, sporting a moustache, salt and pepper crew cut, and the beginnings of a belly, Hemingway is accompanied by a resistance fighter nicknamed Marceau and a young American. He sends one article per month to Collier's, which published Salinger's story, The Hang of It, in its July 1941 issue. Hemingway recognizes Salinger from his photo in Esquire and remembers reading The Heart of a Broken Story. "Have you got anything new to show me?" Salinger pulls out a recent copy of the Saturday Evening Post with his story, Last Day of the Last Furlough. Hemingway reads it and applauds. The two writers order drinks and converse for 2 hours. "Do you know at least what you came here looking for?" "No, but I know what I've lost." First, they keep their masks on, the great braggart writer and the young sycophant private. This kind of deference is a classic of the literary life. Last Day of the Last Furlough was published in July 1944 in the Saturday Evening Post. Written in England before the Normandy landings, tells the story of John F. Gladwell, a junior, who has to return to the war even though he'd rather stay home and read Anna Karenina and The Great Gatsby. He's visited by a big-eared soldier called Vincent Caulfield, 29 years old, whose little brother Holden is missing in action. It's winter, not far from New York, and it's snowing. John is sledding with Matilda, his little sister, and he thinks, "I'm happier than I've ever been in my life. Shoot me, all you sneaking Jap snipers that I've seen in the reels. Who cares?" Vincent Caulfield asks 10-year-old Matilda if she'll marry him. It's no good being with civilians anymore. They don't know what we know. With every story published, Jerry's style darkens, finding its originality and its madness. Little by little, the drink takes effect. Jerry, who secretly prefers Fitzgerald, is pleasantly surprised by the difference between the public and private Hemingway. Hemingway has his cracks, too. Jerry speaks about his meeting in a letter dated September 4, 1944, addressed to his mentor, Whit Burnett, the director of story. "I found him softer than his prose. Compared with Fitzgerald, Hemingway was not an aggressive drunk and took a genuine interest in the budding author. I hope the war would inspire a book," Jerry says, "but now I just don't want to talk about it." I said the same thing at your age," Ernest says, "but writers who have gone to war will always write about it. Even when they're not writing about it, it's already pumping through all your stories in the magazines. Those who came back from the First World War never stopped talking to their kids about it, so they'd know how horrible it was. But it turned them into heroes back from hell and all that stuff. And what was the result? Children who wanted to do just the same. So I swear never to talk about it to anyone. Everyone who fought this time should keep their trap shut. The war will be our iceberg, right?" Hemingway smiles. He likes conversing with a fellow writer. It's relaxing. He sometimes compared his writing to an iceberg peaking above the water. It's kind of satisfying that a young greenhorn remembers it. In a writer's life, people never imagine how rare precise remarks about writing are, even in interviews, reviews, and conversations with colleagues. A young debutante making an attentive remark about your working method? This kind of anomaly happens 4 or 5 times in an artist's life, not more. The war is the underwater part, Jerry goes on. What happens on the page is not even an eighth of what we've seen, right? Writing doesn't mean telling everything, Ernest says. You've got to choose the killer detail. I try, but I don't cut enough. Nobody cuts enough, Hemingway says, looking at his cigarette. Have you read the Bible? The old version, the King James. Read the Chronicles. It's a model narrative. I copied everything from there. It's absolute concision.
Thank you so much.
So I wanted to say something that is important. The translator improves the first work, but then the actor improves the translator's work.
I very much agree.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Lola.
I got one final question before opening up to the audience. So if you have questions for Frederick, please be ready. Raise your hand. We'll get a microphone to you. But I just have one final one before. There's a moment in the book where you write, first love is rarely the most successful, nor the most perfect, but it remains the first. And this seems to me to be at the heart of the book, actually, this idea. It's a book about so many things. It's about, you know, it's about war, it's about celebrity, it's about writing. But at heart, it seems to be about the effect that a first love has on somebody's character.
I see that you have something personal that you want to share with us. No, it's true that we all have shitty love stories. When we are young, we are attracted to the wrong person, and it's terrible and beautiful and very useful. Mm-hmm. So all these disappointments, all these attempts to seduce someone who doesn't give a shit, this is perfect, this is excellent for a novel. Of course, I'm sure that Salinger would have loved to that it happened differently. Mm-hmm. But for me, it was a gold mine. Uh-huh. And I wanted also to talk about these failed love stories and how they build, they construct, mm-hmm. elles vous forgent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Forger en anglais, bon, forger.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, I'm not going to in any way spoil the ending, but there's some moments which I think we get a certain satisfaction, a certain payback from this. If you have a question for Frederick, please don't be shy. Raise your hand. We'll get a microphone to you because there are people upstairs and there are people outside, so they'd like to hear you too. So put your hand up and we'll get it to you. Yeah, over there. Oh, microphone.
Hi.
And I just want to say for the people who are at the first floor, there are many beds if you want to meet each other and touch each other, you can.
I agree.
It's true. Yeah, you know, it's important to say that.
You talked about your gerontophobia and your reluctance to meet an aging Salinger. I was wondering if those two had any connection, and if you think that if you had met him, you would have been cured.
Oh, interesting. Yeah, maybe. Yeah, you're right. You're right. It's too bad. But Salinger was attracted to very young women during all his life. After Oona, he never... even when he was 80 years old, his wife was very much younger than him, so I don't think he would have cured me, because I would if it's your master, you want to become like him, so then I would been attracted to teenage girls to obey the orders of Dark Vader, Dark Salinger, you know. So yeah, I don't know if I would have been cured of my gerontophobia, which in a way is a word easier to use than pedophile. Yeah, gerontophobia is... Okay, my publisher is now very, very, very embarrassed. But it's true. If you are allergic to old, you might be attracted to young, and that's very illegal if you're under 18. And I disagree with all these people who
Do you ever regret not going to Salinger? No, like the decision not to.
Well, I was with a crew of a TV crew, cameraman, producer, and they were all making fun of me because I was too shy I was not brave enough to ring the bell of the great writer, and so I felt very stupid for a few days. But then I started to write this book, so finally, I don't regret because it inspired me something.
Yeah, it probably would not have been the book if you'd
have met Salinger. I don't think so,
yeah. More questions. Is there one right there? We'll just get a microphone to you. Just wait one moment.
Hello. So, Catcher's Right, in the Right, Salinger said that the good book is the one who give you wish to call to the author. So, my question is, do you have this wish to call to someone who is this author? So, I do think it's a good principle to choose a good book.
Thanks.
Well, yeah, it's true. When you read something that really speaks to you, talks to you, and you feel you've connected with a voice, usually you want to meet the person. If it's a dead person, it's more difficult, but it's true. Well, Salinger, it's interesting because he wrote this book and then he disappeared. So, in fact, he says this in his book, but he never wanted to meet anybody. So there is a paradox there. but we can think that maybe he met a few readers.
Any more questions? I think we've got time for one more if somebody is keen. Oh, yeah, right at the back there. Look, gentleman waving his arm.
Hello. And after all your love book, do you have a secret for recover his ex?
Maybe. Well, Salinger has no secret because he didn't really succeed. Well, you should write many books better than Salinger, and maybe she will come back, which is really a cheesy answer.
But it's always good to finish on a cheesy answer. Okay, so we have plenty of copies of Manhattan's Babe. I'm sure Frédéric would be delighted to sign them. And it's a wonderful thing that if you're French and you've already read Oona et Salinger, you wouldn't have read it with the illustrations. So our French members of the audience, I recommend you head to the till. If you're English, you can buy both versions and compare and contrast the translations.
Excellent. You are really a good salesman. I just want to say maybe Raphael Alterio is here. If he's here. Ah, yeah. Okay. So we never met. So please, Raphael Alterio, stand up. This is a very talented young man who did the illustrations for Manhattan's Babe. And the reason we never met is that you worked with Martine Assouline very closely, and you chose extracts of the book to make illustrations about them, right?
Yeah.
Let's explain us how you decided, because I think it's very interesting. It's much better than in my first version. Okay. This one, because in my first version there are pictures, and when you see pictures, there is less room for the reader to imagine and to fantasize and to dream about this very sad story.
Yeah.
And so I think it's how
so
did you
so
choose?
I would like to know which one I wanted to illustrate first. I don't know. Two microphones.
Okay. Oh, okay.
No, I have to say that the book is filled with an atmosphere that I really rely to, and I feel more at ease behind a piece of paper than in front of a crowd. But the thing is that I've never decided to pick this scene instead of another one. It's like just like a flow. It's like the it's like the letters you form. I don't know. It's the whole book is that you have such an atmosphere and images that it was kind of easy to let me go with it.
Yeah, and also I thought, comment on dit aquarelle en anglais?
Watercolor.
Huh? Watercolor. The choice of watercolor, is it for especially for this, to create this atmosphere, dreamy and gloomy and, comment on dit, flou.
Blur, kind of
blurry.
Right? Yeah, like in a memory.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. Yeah. That was a good idea.
I think it's, it relies good with your work. Yeah.
Raphael, you deserve a glass of wine.
Yeah, I do.
And if there are any book collectors, then this is maybe the only opportunity you'll ever get to get the book signed by Frederick and by the illustrator. And I'm a bookseller at heart, so what can I say? And on the subject of a glass of wine, we will be serving wine. This bookshop is going to be converted into the Stork Club for a little while. So please do stay around, have a glass of wine with us, buy books, get them signed by Frederick, and please do give it up one more time for Frederick Beigbeder. And of course, Lola Peplo. Lola.
And I remind you, there are beds at the first floor.
Okay.